We live in a three-dimensional space, right? I mean, together with time, some say that we live in a four-dimensional space-time. But is that it? Or are there higher dimensions? And if so, where are they? Today, we're going to explore hyperspace. Any student of calculus is familiar with the use of integrals to compute the areas of planar regions, that is, areas in two-dimensional space. The definite integral on the interval from A to B is the area under the curve, or the region bounded between the function f of x and the x-axis. Let's take a look at an example. Let f of x be the function 2x squared. On the interval from 0 to 3, the graph of f of x is half of a parabola. And to compute the definite integral is to find the area under the curve of this parabola and above the x-axis. So the integral from 0 to 3 of 2x squared dx comes out to be 2x cubed over 3, evaluated at 3 and evaluated at 0, and then the difference is found, and we find the area. And in this case, the area works out to be 18. So definite integrals can be used to find planar region areas. More importantly, this procedure can be extended into the third dimension to calculate the volume of three-dimensional objects. Cavalieri's principle states that two objects with the same height and cross-sectional area are equal in volume. Therefore, the volume of a prism can be found by doing its base area times its height. We're going to employ this idea and the slicing principle to use our integrals to calculate volume. The volume of a cylinder by slicing. The cross-sectional slice of a cylinder is a circular disc. A circular disc of radius r. And that circular disc has an area of pi r squared. So now we can think of the volume of a cylinder as being a stack of these disks. In other words, if the cylinder has a height of h, we can think of this as h number of disks stacked on top of each other inside the cylinder. And therefore, to find the volume of this cylinder, all we need do is multiply that base area times the height, or here, pi r squared times h. Now, let's situate the height of the cylinder along the x-axis. The area of each slice will remain constant in this orientation, and therefore the area of each slice will always remain pi r squared. So the volume is going to be given by the integral from 0 to h, the height of the cylinder, of the area over this interval. So we're going to integrate, that means to add up all the areas of the disks, and since each cross-sectional slice has an area of pi r squared, that will be our constant area along our interval of integration. So a of x, the area of this slice, is going to be pi r squared. And since the cross-sectional area does not vary, does not change here, in other words, that it's constant, then our integral is going to be the integral from 0 to h of pi r squared dx. Now, when we integrate that, pi r squared is a constant, and we integrate x from 0 to h, giving us the formula pi r squared h, the volume of our cylinder. A little bit about Riemann sums here. So when we have some sort of three-dimensional object that might be weirdly shaped, we can approximate its volume as we cut the slices as we integrate along the x-axis. And so we can imagine that what we're doing here is adding up a whole bunch of different volumes of cylinders that are approximate the volume of the actual object. Along the interval, what we do is we break the interval up into sub-intervals, here n sub-intervals, and we'll add up all the different volumes along each of those. So slices of volumes will be added up along the way here. And the idea is that if we let the number of sub-intervals go to infinity, or the size of the sub-interval go to zero, we'll get the continuous idea of volume when we sum up the areas. Okay, let's do an example with the square pyramid. This one has a variable cross-section, and so consider that the square pyramid is oriented so that the x-axis is along its height. The cross-sectional area will be the area of a square with side length u, and thus have an area of u squared. And integrating from 0 to h, the height of the pyramid, we'll be able to deduce the volume. Now, using similar triangles and setting up a proportion between two similar triangles, we can write an equation or solve for u here in terms of x. And here we get u is equal to s times x divided by h. So our area is always u squared here in terms of the square area, cross-sectional area. And so substituting in s x over h in for u, we get the volume, the area to be s squared x squared over h squared. And substituting that into the integral from 0 to h to find our volume, what we can do here is we can separate the constant out of this, s squared over h squared, and integrate x squared dx from 0 to h. Since x squared has an antiderivative of x cubed over 3, and integrating that from 0 to h, we get our volume to work out to be, after a little cancellation, s squared times h over 3. So the volume of a pyramid is the side squared times h divided by 3, the base area times the height over 3. In calculating the volume of a 3-ball centered at the origin of radius r, we make use of the Pythagorean theorem. Each slice is a disk of varying radii length. From the Pythagorean theorem, we get r squared is equal to x squared plus y squared, or y squared is equal to r squared minus x squared. And so the variable disk area is a equals pi y squared, or pi times r squared minus x squared. Now when we integrate this from 0 to r along the x-axis, we get half of the sphere's volume. By symmetry, once we find this, we will simply multiply that volume by 2 to get the entire sphere's volume. The integral from 0 to r of pi times r squared minus x squared dx gives us the integrals split up for pi r squared and pi x squared, both integrated from 0 to r. Carefully evaluating the integrals from 0 to r, we will get the volume of half of the sphere to be 2 pi r cubed over 3. And, as I said before, by symmetry, if we multiply the half sphere by 2, we will get the volume of the whole sphere, which would be 2 times 2 pi r cubed over 3, or 4 pi r cubed over 3, the volume of a sphere.
Bust it.
To a mathematician, three-dimensional space is the set R3, which is the set of all ordered triples x, y, z, where x, y, and z are real numbers. In R3, we can define the notion of distance using the distance formula in three-dimensional space. Let's take two points, P and P bar. And distance between those two points in three-dimensional space is given by the formula d equals the square root of x minus x bar squared plus y minus y bar squared plus z minus z bar squared. This formula might look familiar to you from the distance formula from coordinate geometry in high school. Now in four dimensions, or four-dimensional space, we would have a four-tuple, or an ordered four numbers, x, y, z, and w in R4. And to extend the distance formula would be the square root of x minus x bar, y minus y bar, z minus z bar, and w minus w bar, all quantities squared summed together under the square root. So if we want to extend this to n number of dimensions in Rn, okay, then the points might be labeled a little bit differently with subscripts x1, x2, x3, up to xn for each coordinate point for p and p bar. And so then we can naturally extend to n dimensions this idea of distance, the distance between any two n-dimensional points. In a more compact way, we can write this distance formula using the summation or sigma notation. We can visualize a three-dimensional sphere. It's pretty easy, actually. The sphere is very symmetric. It looks the same under just about any rigid motion, any isometry. So when it comes to visualizing a four-dimensional sphere, or any shape for that matter in four dimensions, it's pretty difficult. Mathematicians make a pretty good distinction between spheres and balls. And in four dimensions, the fourth sphere would be considered the shell in four dimensions, just the skin or the surface of a four-dimensional sphere, given by the equation x squared plus y squared plus z squared plus w squared equals r squared. But if we want to contain all the volume within it, we need to write this as an inequality, less than or equal to r squared. And that is what we refer to as a ball in four or n dimensions. So what we'll focus on to find the volume in hyperspace is the volume of an n-dimensional ball. That would be a sphere and all the volume inside of it contained. So the four-dimensional ball given by this inequality and the n-dimensional volume that we're trying to find here, we're going to start with some things that we know. Let's see if there's a pattern. First, in two dimensions, the volume of a ball would be the area of the ball, which would definitely just be the area of the circle, pi r squared. We found earlier that the volume of a sphere in three dimensions is 4 pi r cubed over 3. So if we could find a pattern for a four-dimensional ball or an n-dimensional ball, we would be able to calculate its volume. So imagine that our four-dimensional ball is centered at the origin, 0, 0, 0, 0. Also, imagine that our four-dimensional ball is laid out so that it is along the x-axis going between negative r and positive r, since this is a radius of r that we're dealing with in our ball. So x is in the interval from negative r to positive r. Now, for a fixed value of x, since we're integrating along x, the slice that would be above that x value is the set of all points with that particular x value, as well as all the other coordinates satisfying this inequality. This inequality represents a three-dimensional ball of radius r squared minus x squared to the 1/2 power, or the square root of r squared minus x squared. And therefore, the volume of this three-dimensional ball with this particular radius is 4 pi thirds r squared minus x squared raised to the 3/2 power. We'll see that this is going to help us make a general extension to n dimensions. So now, if we want to find the four-dimensional ball of radius r from negative r to positive r, we're going to integrate the three-dimensional ball over the interval along dx. And by symmetry, we can cut this integral in half and just double it later on to get the volume. So we can now integrate this between 0 and r. In order to do this particular integral, we'll have to do a little bit of a substitution here, and a trigonometric substitution at that. So with a little bit of practice, you get to learning how to doing these with some ease, but this one we make the choice of x equals r sine theta. And as you can see, as we follow through to find dx and the integrand, things simplify very nicely. And we get an integrand of r cubed times cosine cubed of theta. So the four-dimensional ball is the integral from 0 to r of 8 pi over 3, r cubed, cosine cubed, theta d theta. And this is going to be integrated between 0 and pi over 2. When we calculate this integral, we'll first pull out any constants that we have, and then just leave the integral in terms of our here theta. And when we integrate this, we're going to make use of a formula. Now, we could do this by integration by parts a repetitive number of times to get down to the answer, but we can just use the reduction formula for the integrals of sine and cosine, powers of those, and make our lives a little bit simpler here. So the integral of 0 to pi over 2 of cosine to the fourth power theta d theta will ultimately work out to, 3 pi over 16. Now, if we multiply this by the constant that we had pulled out in front earlier, our four-dimensional ball with a radius of r will have a volume of pi squared r to the fourth all over 2. So that's the formula for a four-dimensional ball of radius r. And it is the integral from negative r to r of the volume of a one-dimensional lower ball. So we can use this to essentially find the volume of any n-dimensional ball. The power of calculus. Now, in general, if we wanted to calculate an n-dimensional ball of radius r's volume, we could use the formula 1 over the gamma function of n over 2 plus 1 multiplied by pi raised to the n over 2 power times r to the nth power. The gamma function is connected to finding factorials, something we may cover in another video. Now, what we can do is we can use this to investigate what happens to volume as we increase in dimension. Tracking the volume of the n-dimensional unit ball. In one dimension, a unit circle is just a line segment of length 2. In two dimensions, the unit circle has an area. And since the unit circle has a radius of 1, that area is going to work out to be pi, approximately 3.14159. And the 2x2 box of area 2 squared is the smallest square that contains the unit circle. The volume of a three-dimensional unit ball is 4 pi over 3. And that is the ball contained in a cube of volume 2 cubed. And the ball of a four-dimensional sphere contained in the smallest hypercube of volume 2 to the fourth power is pi squared over 2. So now if we track or plot the unit ball volume u sub n as we increase the number of dimensions n, we discover that the volume peaks out at n equals 5 dimensions. We also notice that the ratio of the unit ball's volume to the volume of the smallest cube that contains it goes to 0 as n goes to infinity. And this is because the spheres curve more in higher dimensions. Another curiosity is that if you add up all of the volumes from the even numbered dimensions of the unit ball, that sum adds up to e raised to the pi power. So in comparison, when we look at how much space the unit circle or unit sphere or unit ball takes up inside the box that tries to contain it, we see that the percentage of that starts to go down as the number of dimensions goes up. As a matter of fact, if we look at just dimensions 2 and 3 here, all right, the unit circle takes up about 79% of the square's area, whereas the volume of the unit sphere in 3 dimensions takes up only about 52% of the cube. So we may not be able to see hyperspace. But now we can measure hyperspace. And that's pretty awesome. Hey, thanks for watching. I hope you enjoyed. Hit that subscribe, like, and notification bell for more videos. Stay tuned.